The amazing thing is we have to remember Filippino may only have been about 14 or 15 when he did this, but he was an artist's son and precociously talented. In the previous episode, we looked at the removal of the frame and the restoration of Botticelli's and Filippino's Adoration of the Kings. But while that work was taking place, the painting was also being examined by the scientific and conservation departments using several different imaging techniques. In this episode, we're going to show you how we use these imaging techniques in conjunction with traditional connoisseurship to investigate which elements of the painting were painted by Botticelli and which were painted by Filippino.
My name is Marta Melchiorre, and I am one of the scientists at the National Gallery who contributed to the technical investigation of this painting.
I'm Jill Dunkerton, restorer in the conservation department, and I've been responsible for the restoration of the painting, but also for the overall interpretation of the results of the scientific examination. The panel was painted at an early stage in the careers of both artists. It's likely that they were both trained in the very busy Renaissance workshop of Fra Filippo Lippi, who was Filippino's father, but they wouldn't have been there necessarily at the same time, as Filippino was much younger than Botticelli. Artists in the Renaissance didn't work independently and alone. They usually had busy workshops with assistants carrying out all sorts of tasks. They had young artists in training, and also quite often experienced painters who would help them out on big projects, such as fresco cycles, large altarpieces. But what's unusual about this painting is that it's quite small. It has long been suspected that Filippino was working with Botticelli on it, and we know that he was in Botticelli's workshop in 1472, approximately the date of this painting, and he may well have transferred immediately to Botticelli's shop on the death of his father a few years previously. Renaissance artists, when they were working on projects such as cassoni, which were chests made for weddings, were obviously up against deadlines because there was the wedding. And so they often collaborated with other artists. And we know that Botticelli collaborated with Filippino on such cassoni. But the division of labor is extremely clear cut, with one panel being painted by Botticelli, another by Filippino. And so it's not that complicated to sort them out. But this painting is extremely complicated because it seems that both together were working on it. As a result of the scientific examination, we were able to show that there was an extremely unusual collaboration in a set of circumstances that we still don't quite understand, but we're going to show you some of the highlights of our discoveries. In the first instance, you can look at the surface of the picture. And this is the basis of traditional connoisseurship, which involves the careful looking at and of paintings, but based on a very thorough knowledge of the works of the artists that you're looking at. In this case, the early works of both artists. We can use connoisseurship to work out which painter was responsible for which parts of the painting, up to a point anyway. At the National Gallery, the process of dividing the hands through connoisseurship is helped by the fact that in our extraordinary collection, we have two paintings of the same subject, the Adoration of the Kings, one entirely by Botticelli, the Tondo, painted shortly after the painting that we're talking about now, but also one by the very young Filippino. And so we can look at those to get to know our artists. There are certain general characteristics that you can immediately use to start to divide up the figures. Botticelli, throughout his life, was a great storyteller, and his figures in the painting are very animated and expressive. They're also highly individualized. In these early works, he tends to dress his figures in very complicated, multicolored costumes. In Filippino's style, they're somehow cooler and calmer, very, very beautiful, but more static, and often the draperies are full length and all of the same colour. This difference in character between the figures is very apparent at the junction between a group that we believe to be by Filippino and a group by Botticelli, where we actually have a Filippino figure dressed in turquoise and white talking to a Botticelli figure. When we go in a little bit closer, this is still something you can see from looking at the surface of the painting. It's evident that the artists differed in how they modelled the faces of their figures. They'd had exactly the same training in the Florentine tradition of tempera painting, and so the first stage was putting in an underpaint of a light green earth. This was a tradition in Florentine painting and had been for centuries. However, we can also observe the painting surface more closely with a microscope. Photographs can be taken, and in fact, more than 200 such microphotographs were taken by our colleague, Rachel Billinge, in the course of the investigation. And here we're just going to show you two. When we look closely, we can see that Botticelli used so much lead white in his modelling of the flesh that the green earth is almost completely covered. You would barely know it was there. And then he worked up the details with touches of red paint and also lots of finely hatched shading. And then the features, the eyes, the nose and so on, are picked out in mixtures, often using quite a bit of black. They're very strongly defined because his figures are so strongly characterised. Filippino, on the other hand, applied his flesh tones more thinly and didn't use nearly so much lead white. And so as a result, we see the green earth and he's using it as part of the modelling system of his flesh tones. Also, when he does details such as eyes and nose and mouth, he tends to model them using brown mixtures, often just containing earth pigments. There isn't the black that you see in Botticelli. Our observations based on traditional connoisseurship, that is very careful looking, are supported by technical examination. And this also supplied fascinating clues as to what may have happened in the course of painting the picture and how the artists actually collaborated.
One method that we used for our scientific investigation was macro X-ray fluorescence scanning. This is a spectral imaging technique used to map the distribution of chemical elements in the paint, both at and below the surface of the painting. And since different pigments contain specific elements, such as lead, copper, mercury, iron, and so on, we can use this technique to investigate the composition and structure of the paint passages in a completely non-invasive way. This provides insights into an artist's painting technique, but can also reveal changes that were made during the course of painting. This is the XRF map for iron, and it therefore shows the distribution of pigments containing this element. And it clearly highlights how the difference in how the two artists modeled their figures. So if we look closely at this group of figures, we see that those painted by Filippino appear fairly bright, showing the iron from the yellow and red earth pigments, including the uppermost paint passages, but also from the green earth used in the very first underpaint. And this results in a very distinctive appearance of the eye sockets, what we started to call, together with our colleague Catherine Higgett, who first noticed this, the Filippino's panda eyes. The ads by Botticelli instead look more like black and white photo negative, I would say. And this is because the lead white containing paint that he used to solidly model these figures covers completely the green hair from the underpaint. So what we see in the iron XRF map is only the contribution from the earth pigment in the uppermost paint passages.
The scientific investigation didn't just support the attribution of the figures, but it also revealed a very complex story about the collaboration, and we can just show you some of the highlights. Infrared imaging techniques proved particularly useful in those areas where the pigments and the buildup of paint allowed the infrared light to penetrate to show the preliminary underdrawing on the white gesso of the panel. This shows because the underdrawing has been done with a black drawing material. When we looked at the infrared of the painting as a whole, it became evident that almost all the underdrawing that we could see was by Botticelli, and we use connoisseurship when we're looking at underdrawings as well. We have to compare them with other underdrawings, known underdrawings by the artist. And the style that we could see in most of the figures was very typical of early works by Botticelli. And we believe that he started the painting and actually did all the underdrawing on his own. He even began to paint before Filippino became involved. In the previous video, we showed that parts of the landscape, and in particular the distant landscape with the little town and the rocks, were actually quoted from a painting or a composition designed by Jan van Eyck. We believe, and most art historians believe, that the artist who's most likely to have copied a landscape from van Eyck is Filippino. Botticelli was never very interested in landscape, and when he paints them himself, they're usually quite simple and quite generalized. But Filippino was fascinated by early Netherlandish painting and continued to quote from early Netherlandish paintings throughout his career. Infrared examination shows that underneath this introduced Eyckian landscape, which we believe to be Filippino's, there is actually a completely different idea for a landscape, which looks entirely as though it was by Botticelli. We can see that where we now have bushes, a tree, and some sort of bulgy rocks, there were horsemen and figures rushing to attend the adoration of the kings, the tail end of the procession. The animated and excited way that they behave, and also the drawing style, is entirely characteristic of Botticelli. But unfortunately, with ordinary infrared, the dark green malachite pigment of the bush obscures the procession, and we can only see the hoofs of the horses.
More horses and riders emerge under the bushes on the left side. In this other image that was produced applying advanced processing method to the data collected with our cutting-edge reflectance imaging spectroscopy system that works deeper in the infrared compared to traditional infrared reflectography.
When we return to looking at the rocks in the painting, more traditional infrared reflectography shows us an underdrawing style, which is very different from that of Botticelli. It's very confident, but the lines are shorter and more discontinuous. The amazing thing is we have to remember Filippino may only have been about 14 or 15 when he did this, but he was an artist's son and precociously talented. A very similar style of underdrawing appears in the figures that we have identified as having been painted by Filippino. Well, that might make sense, but how can that be if we're going to argue that the painting was begun by Botticelli, who would therefore have done all the underdrawing of the painting before he began to paint the picture and Filippino got involved?
Well, the figures painted by Filippino have a very characteristic appearance in the various infrared images, including, and I would say in particular, in this narrow band false color reflectance image, where they look much brighter than the figures painted by Botticelli instead. And we found that these relate to the fact that Filippino painted these figures in an area where some earlier paint had been scraped away.
A 3D scan taken by my colleague Rachel Billinge of the surface actually gives a clearer picture of those areas where the paint has been scraped away. You can actually see the edge of the scraping, and even one place where whoever scraped it off actually gouged into the gesso of the ground. In a way, it's amazing that we'd never seen this before. Equally remarkable is the second king, who's kneeling down, doffing his crown in front of the child. The draperies in the figure look as though they're painted by Botticelli, and there are lots of changes in them, but the style is Botticelli's, the colours and so on. But the head is very clearly by Filippino. We could see that with the XRF mapping. And so it would seem that we have another area which was scraped away, which is confirmed by the 3D scan. I suspect that this king, since he's the middle of the three, must be Melchiorre, Marta's king. You might think from this evidence that Botticelli painted the picture and that Filippino came along later and added bits of landscape and scraped off bits and changed it. But in fact, the technical evidence doesn't support this argument at all, nor does traditional connoisseurship, because it's quite clear that Botticelli came in and then finished off the picture, adding the dark green paint that fills in the grass of the foreground. But while he was doing it, he made lots of the sorts of decisions that the senior artist would be making. It's also done quite broadly and confidently. I think Filippino would have been a little bit more careful and fussy. Botticelli never spends too much time on unimportant parts of paintings. And this is supported when we look at the XRF maps of the lower part of the picture.
Where indeed we see that there is a change in the height of one of the figures added by Filippino in the scraped area, but also that by applying the green paint, Botticelli covered the oldest king gift.
I have a feeling that might have been a mistake, or that they actually forgot to put another one back, because one of the other kings, Melchiorre, does have his gift, and that's a lovely gold vase. But there's just a sense that they had to get this picture finished.
We learned quite a lot about the collaboration of the two artists throughout the collaboration of our departments at the National Gallery. But what are the open questions that we are left with?
Well, the question that science and that we can't answer at the moment is, why did this happen? Why were the figures scraped off? It's just possible that there were portraits of Florentine notables included, and there are some heads that survive, in Botticelli heads that do look as though they could be portraits. And maybe those people became persona non grata to the organization or to the private patron who commissioned the picture. But we don't know who the patron was. We don't know where it originally was displayed. And so it's really over to the art historians. We need somebody to make a lucky find in an archive in Florence and identify who the patron was and where the painting was displayed. If you would like to learn more about the collection, please click here or here. Thank you very much for watching, and we hope to see you next time.